Hey, we are live now on our special hangout where we will be talking about this essay by John Quiggin called iPencil, A Project of the Mixed Economy. Joining me so far, we have Charles Thomas.
Hello.
And Travis Retriever.
Bark. Yeah, it's nice to be here.
And I guess we'll see who else shows up as well. I sent invites to all the co-hosts and all the patrons again, so we'll see. Now, of course, I think we all know what iPencil is. It's Leonard Reed's famous essay from the 1950s, where he really shows, I think quite brilliantly, the concept of bottom-up spontaneous organization. So you guys have read it, right?
As someone who... I read a bits and pieces of the iPencil, and again, I try to expand my horizons and such. But again, you know, I see what it was and everything else. It was I didn't read it as a kid, but I read it like later as an adult and such. So yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not a piece for children. I mean, children could probably read it, but it's written for general audiences.
Mm-hmm. So his first argument, I look at it and it's like, he goes into, my family tree was literally a tree from such and such forest. And then Leonard Reed says that. And then he talks about, yeah, but it's managed by the U.S. Forest Registry or something or other. Yeah. And I'm like, really?
Let me get down to that. This is the website here, A Project of the Mixed Economy. And so we're getting down...
And like, really? That old canard?
Yeah. Yeah,
I think the reason why people pull that... It's been beaten down in someone's head all this time. It's just like, okay, well, this is how things work. So, that's how it is.
Yeah, so the whole point here is there is no mastermind, there is no top-down thing going on here. So he quotes Leonard Reed... My family tree begins with what in fact is a tree, a cedar, a straight grain that grows in Northern California and Oregon. And the part you mentioned, Travis, that would probably be in a forest managed by the U.S. Forest Service or the Bureau of Land Management or maybe a similar state agency. Well,
yes,
no.
Our
commercial forests are maintained by the companies. It's, Weyerhaeuser, it's Boise Cascade, it's people like that. We get our timber in this country from commercially owned forests, not government owned forests.
And even if it were true, as I've been trying to say, he does realize, because, if government doesn't do it, then, it just can't be done, right? Corporate ownership and state banking. So really, it's just as wrong can be.
Yeah, exactly. It's to the point, it says that your body owns to the state, and it will die, and it just basically says that right there, saying that will probably be forest management. It's like saying it's a proud, like he's so happy to say, yes, it's a part of the state. Like, just, it's sad in a way that someone is just say so happy to be gleeful that your entire life, your family, and everything else is like drawn from this, from the whole state. You like say you live here, you die here. It's this. I'm like, it doesn't make, much logical sense,
Yeah. So we have this next paragraph where he talks about all the persons and the numberless skills. Most of those people would have acquired their basic skills in public schools and learned more in colleges, trade schools, and so on, mostly public or publicly funded. And, of course, when Leonard Reed wrote this essay, there was no Federal Department of Education. You had states involved in schools, but not for, I think, about 30 years or so. So for most of our history as a country, the state has not been involved in schooling.
Yeah. And as I said before, it sounds like he's trying to call them hypocrites or something. I mean, it reminds me of the, we'll use the roads, ergo you're a hypocrite, or some other such nonsense.
No, I think it's just a microcosm fallacy, the term I've applied to it. Whereas if you can find one tiny little thing in here the government did, then,
you are all owed to the government, which is complete BS. It's... again, it just seems like it's funny because all schools and public schools, which it's funny enough since I feel like after the states, like, we have full-on government education, I think the intelligence of the country get down lower and lower and lower. I mean, I honestly look at what, you know, learned, like, back in the old days, and you know, from the late 80s and early 90s and such, to by a whole educational spectrum. I feel like I know a lot more than what the people, those kids and the kids who graduated before me, and it's just like I know less than what my parents know, and the people behind me know less than I know, and these people are graduating high school and college, and it just makes no sense.
Well, and it's also the fact that, like, one of the skills that Leonard Reed mentioned in his essay was logging. How much logging did you learn in public schools?
Zelch.
Most of the things that we know to do our jobs, we learned on the job.
Yeah, I learned. I was a landscaper. I didn't learn any of the stuff I had in school, so I had to learn on-the-job training. I had to know how to do weeding. I had to know how to, ride a lawnmower and everything, edging, planting, everything that goes in the steps of being a landscaper and everything else.
Yeah. All right, so we've got this next part. Next up is the rail trip. Reed's pencil mentioned the line, but is presumably on the network of the Union Pacific Railroad, and why would he presume that?
So, okay, just a quick check. Is this entire thing just going to be one microcosm fallacy after another? Because that's what it seems like so far.
And that's what it sells by. It doesn't really have any type of nothing really intelligent debates, but yet nothing they say. See, it's all about this stuff, and you should be bad. You should feel bad, which I feel like I read the whole thing. It just, I understand what he's going through and trying to say that, and I really do, but part of me is like, just seems like it's a bit, the smugness again, saying, see, you are always wrong, libertarians. You should always be here, or independents, or whatever. You should always pledge fealty to governments and everything else. Pledge fealty to it, and without any reckless challenge or anything else. It just, you must pledge fealty to it, regardless of how you feel about it whatsoever. It's more like a cultist behavior, than actual type of real debate.
Yeah. But, I mean, this Union Pacific Railroad, I wonder if he talks about it, created by an act of Congress under Abraham Lincoln to build the Transcontinental Railroad. I wonder if he realizes how much of a joke that was considered by people at the time.
Yeah.
So basically, it was like the Amtrak of its day, right?
Well, and it's hardly like we need government to build railroads. Most of the railroad tracks here on the East Coast were actually laid down by Western Union and other private companies.
So the private companies laid down the tracks, and Amtrak, the government-built company, just runs them off the rails, sadly.
Well, I think a lot of them are still cargo lines, but Amtrak, I think they have a monopoly now on passenger trains. I don't think anyone's allowed to compete with them.
That's the problem.
And people always go, well, at least if you have one person running it, at least you know what's going on. At least you can complain. I'm like, no, you can't. You can't really complain when you have one person or anything else. It's if you have one thing that is, if Apple only said, only this was the only MP3, this is an iPod, by the way. I'm sorry, Shane, I don't want to get your whole video copyrighted. I apologize.
There are no product placements here. It's just an example.
It just says that it would be the quality will suffer. It will suffer, and that things will deteriorate. You need other things to you need other competition to drive the product to make it better. Because, simply put,
if they're the only game in town, then what incentive do they have to improve? I mean,
exactly.
What are you gonna do? Go to their competition? Oh wait, they don't have any competition. So there we go.
I'm kind of reminded of that South Park episode with the cable guy who's playing with his nipples.
No. Oh, you want to go? Want to get Dish Network? Oh, that's right. You can't afford it.
No, you can't. There aren't any other cable companies. We're the only ones in town.
And that's
And I'm glad.
And that's the world.
And be glad, yeah, I wasn't sure to why people on apples.
And that's why no one actually, again, it's just, that's why I just can't really, you know, I like trains. I think trains is a great little medium, great way to, not be, but great way to go back and forth, but the cost is just, it hurts the wallet. It hurts the pocket.
John was posting about that in our little Skype discussion group, if I can scroll up here a second to...
Spoiler warning, it's actually cheaper and shorter of a trip to just get a plane ticket, no longer.
Yeah, because he was going, I think he was going Jacksonville to New York, no stops, Amtrak was $120 per person and took 14 hours. The flight he took the next year was $60 per person, this is all one way. And despite the fact that there were six stops, I have no idea why there would have been six stops, but even with six stops, it only took 6 hours to get there.
I think it's the plane and such. It takes shorter to fly. But trains does not just excuse to have take so that take so long. Mm-hmm. You know, it's taking so long. And Travis trying to flex his muscles.
You showing us what you got there, Travis?
Yep.
All right. Well, we're talking about monopolies a bit ago. So Quiggin says, the pencil forgets to mention its invention and patenting by Nicolas Conte in the late 18th century. Quiggin forgets to mention that the pencil is older than that.
that's really the most simple thing. Well, pencil has been around for hundreds and hundreds of years before someone trademarked it. You know, it's, you know, people say, oh, the pencil was this. I'm like, no, it's just... I don't understand how you, supposedly someone who's an intellectual, mess that up. I mean, it's like there's dropping the ball.
It actually
this was made back in
2000. That one cracked. What happened was a guy actually tried to patent a stick for playing catch with a dog. I wish I was making that up.
Oh, they've patented swinging on a swing sideways, peanut butter and jelly with a crust cut off. Just all sorts of crazy things.
Yeah, it's been okay. So in fact, there's a one I think was someone trying to do one with podcast. I remember, and I think
Adam Carolla's been fighting that one for a while. Yeah,
Jesus.
I think last time I heard, he's actually doing a pretty good job with it. But yeah, again, someone who didn't know what the pencil was like, right back early days of 1662. I mean, it was that was the first discovery of graphite and everything else. I mean, a little look at Wikipedia would have told you these things. And yet, this was made back in 2011. There was no excuse for this.
Yeah.
So, in addition to microcosm fallacies, let's also add just flat out misinformation as well.
Yeah.
And
so,
what do you think about this next? If you're listening, you probably say, "Oh, they're just nitpicking."
But the whole thing is made of nets, so there you go.
Yeah. So anyway, the next part talks about the company that made it, a multinational consumer goods conglomerate with over 20,000 employees and dozens of different brands. Obviously, someone sees a fair bit of benefit in dictating and forcibly directing the work of these thousands of employees rather than relying exclusively on transactions in the marketplace.
Yeah, and they're called the government.
Workers of the world, unite. Yeah.
But, I mean, this is just completely missing the point. The point is, there's no way that this company can do it. All they're doing is kind of like just at the last minute putting all the things together. That's all they're doing. Mm-hmm. If they tried to do it all themselves, they couldn't. And actually, you know, he talks about, you know, multinational conglomerates. Well, I mean, the way these things are set up is they're set up to be decentralized because they work better decentralized than when you try to manage mm-hmm. everything from the top down.
Wisdom of crowds, OP. Google it.
Mm. Yeah, everyone tries to think that, you know, again, I'm not saying corporations are awesome or anything else. They got some shady stuff there, but it just, again, I feel like the Empire corporate stuff is just goes a little too far in such things. See these, oh, how dare these type of corporations do this, that, the other, even though it's been proven that, you know, more often than not, it's been overblown, or, you know, just say that, oh, they're evil, we're taking advantage of these workers, even though, you know, it's just, but that's just my thing. It's just, but more often than not, the over stuff and everything else is probably due to, say, regulations made by the government of, you know, where they are being located. So, you know, if you just do a little research, most often than not, that,
yeah,
you know, you find this stuff out.
All right, so he talks about the idea of market organization. To an extent, that might well seem miraculous. But that doesn't mean that markets are the only or invariably the best way to organize production. The majority of economic activity takes place without any direct connection to markets undertaken in the household or government sector or within large corporations that trade in the market sector but use central planning to organize their own activities. The boundaries are constantly shifting as some activities shift between household, government, and market sectors as household, governments, and firms outsource some activities and integrate others.
No, they outsource. They take all the money and give it back to the wealthy and everything else. That's what they do. But, you know, it's stuff like, you know, saying that, oh, it's the government, everything. It's a, you know, it's, we just have to work together. I'm like, no, it doesn't work. It hasn't worked. In fact, you know, it's been proven. I remember actually looking at this in my class a couple of weeks ago, that, you know, the way our money is, it's dropping, actually. Our wealth is getting lower and lower. And it's been going on for, like, you know, people say, oh, just no more central planning, that's going to fix it. Yeah, we already been trying that for how many years now, and it's haven't worked. And, you know, it's, but something doesn't work, you stop doing it. But seeing the government just go double down on it and just keep going more and more, digging, you know, themselves into a hole that they'll never, ever get out. Instead of actually this, they just, you know, like that old Simpson episode saying, you know, they'll just keep digging and then, you know, just say, you know, just got to keep digging up. You got to dig up. Like, you know, dig up.
Yeah, but I don't think this guy even understands what economics is. Economics is about any interaction between two or more people. I mean, if, you know, you meet a friend for dinner somewhere, then that is an economic exchange because you're both getting something out of it. You both give up, you know, your time and whatever you spend on the meal or whatever, but you gain the benefit of each other's company, and that's why you do it. And that's still economics.
And you know, so it's a profit motive and such. I think people are still hold on saying, but that's, you know, when you have profit and such, it's when you have, say, for example, think, oh, you think economic and profit, they think, well, money. But it's not only about money, it's about, again, time or energy and everything else. It's not all about profits and such.
Yeah, the enjoyment you get out of someone's company can be profit just as much as, you know, quarterly stock reports or whatever.
Again, it's about, you know, people just are, you know, their mind stuff. It's drained into people's mind that profit is money. But funny enough, money as a concept is only there for as a, you know, just for trading goods. That's what it is. Mm-hmm. It's about trading goods and, you know, this type of stuff, this basic thing that most people don't understand. It's just about trading goods. I mean, money does not automatically come with power. It's just how you wield and everything else like that. But, you know,
again, money just makes it more efficient, but money isn't actually what it's about.
Yeah. You know, again, I could be talking crazy talk, so. Letting you know. But continue, Shane.
All right.
I'm sorry, Travis, if you had something to say.
All right, so the next part reads, the fact that a particular form of organization exists and functions does not prove that it is optimal. It is certainly possible to imagine forms of modern society in which markets and private property play no role, or forms in which there are markets in everything. Yeah, I guess you can also imagine unicorns and fairies and leprechauns. There's all sorts of things you can imagine.
So wasn't he just talking about how, you know, oh, well, this exists, that doesn't prove it's... Seriously, wasn't he just talking about how, oh, well, this other stuff exists, there's more than markets? Make up your mind, Ippy. Seriously.
It's only that. Is that me? Nope.
No, that
must be you, Travis.
Sorry, yeah. Luckily, I can turn that off.
It's live, folks.
Oh, goodness.
Yeah.
Oh, well. Oh, and then someone said, I'm going to say, copyright infringement on that phone call. That sound.
Well, we broadcast the ringtone. That was, oh no, we're in trouble now. Okay.
You'd be surprised. People would be that petty. But it is. It's, again, he's picking and choosing his arguments and not really doing a good job at it. I read it. I understand what he's trying to do, saying, you know, central planning and markets and, you know, trying to argue what the system is, saying at the end of the day, you might have this man's flaws, but it works. But honestly, the more I look at it, I'm like, and, you know, I'm not saying 100% libertarianism or anything else, but as the independent person who, you know, tries to figure out all the stuff, I'm just saying maybe we might go a different way, a different type of standard, instead of just saying, you know, the system works even though there might be deep problems with it, which that's what I think he's trying to say.
How about something more than our imagination? How about actually, you know, looking at reality?
Some people just don't, you know, again, they don't want to really open their minds up and just say, maybe, just maybe something's wrong. Instead, they just want to go class with the familiar, you know.
So the next part says, and within the broad class of mixed economies, there's a wide range of possibilities. Most goods and services have somewhere and sometime been provided by governments, somewhere and sometime by private markets. Yeah, so what?
And his point is...
our way is better because we have a mixture of both.
Yeah.
And honestly, I think as someone who looks, you know, as, again, I look at this as a, you know, someone who's, you know, independent, non-libertarian and such, I look at this and it just says, well, maybe we need to look at our system, which is not working. I mean, any person with any type of any integrity can look at the system we have right now and see how it's, you know, most people, you know, are not really getting any type of good, getting a good deal out of this economy, getting screwed, you know, can see this thing is not working. So why do we have to continue to be having this whole mixed market by the government and such? And more often than not, the government just continues to bail out people who caused the messes to begin with. Sorry for that.
No, that's fine. We're actually getting towards the end now, so I don't think time's going to be an issue. I was kind of hoping we get more people in, but hey. Okay, so... Yeah, I said that part. Nevertheless, the broad outlines of the mixed economy have remained broadly stable since the 1940s, surviving both the challenge from comprehensive central planning in the Soviet Union and the push for privatization that began in the 1980s and ended as a program with a credible theoretical foundation, if not as an ideological agenda, in the global financial crisis. Any serious policy program has to take account of this fact. Travis,
serious move towards privatization? Is he out of his mind? Did he not look up the fact that the amount of funding for financial regulations alone more than tripled during Reagan? Good lord. Folks,
no one looks at history.
Actions greater than or more actions are more important than words in politics. And
I think a lot of people just love the words of, I mean, seriously, they love the boisterous thing about presidents and such. I mean, they love that, but at the end of the day, it just feels like, you know, they don't. The actions should always count, and sadly, in the culture in America, the actions are just, you know what they do. They blame. You know, it's the Republicans' fault, it's the Democrats' fault, it's this thing and that thing. But yet, no one takes the responsibility and say, hey, you know what? We made mistakes. I made some mistakes, but I'm going to work with this so-and-so, and we can make something and be actually, you know, make this country better. But no one wants to do that. No one wants to have the strength to actually say,
and of course,
you know what?
Well, if they're unable, Well, they talk about how great and how much better than their party, but if they're unable to, even when they have a majority, overcome that, then all that tells me is that they admit to being incompetent boobs. Well, not that we needed any more proof, but whatevs.
But yet they still get voted. And the people who would actually would do change and do some positive work, regardless of what political affiliation they have, would actually be sitting on the sidelines and just told the window seat to just sit down and look at the pretty pictures instead of actually, you know, getting anything done.
I'm just amazed at the fact that, you know, before the financial crisis, the libertarians and the Austrian economists were the ones complaining about what's going on. Hey, this is a housing bubble. Hey, we're pumping all this money in. This is bad. You got to stop doing this. And everyone said, oh, you kooky libertarians. Oh, no. Nothing bad's going to happen. We've done it. We've beaten the boom and bust cycle. Isn't it great that we didn't listen to those kooky free market people? Yay, happy days are here again. And then the financial crisis hits and it's, hey, did you see what those free market people did?
Yeah,
it's just.
I remember. Jesus.
I lost my job because of that. Great, awesome, and this is funny because again, these people who will say all this stuff but yet no responsibility, they always blame. And it'll take until the point that even after all of this happens under their watch, and everything that's happened under the economy and all the other stuff, they'll look and say, well. It wasn't our fault. We did everything right. It was the libertarians and all this other stuff. Peter Schiff, even though he was screaming from the mountaintops and saying, this is going to happen, and yet it's somehow his fault.
I'm like, specifically, how could it have been the libertarians' fault when none of us were even in power in the first place? Jesus, use your brains, yeah. People.
Because reasons. Because of the reasons.
Yeah, the potato is strong with these people.
They just, again, no consequence to their actions. And until people, I don't know how, you know, voting or whatever, I think, you know, getting around it, these guys will never actually have any consequence. I mean, they always fill their pockets up. They can do insider trading with no type of any type of comeuppance or nothing. They are the lords and ladies, and the president is basically a king. And, you know, and basically we're going to have, you know, another one. I mean, we're going to a coronation, either a Bush or a Hillary, or another Clinton. So just sit back, people, and enjoy the ride.
Yeah. Okay, so he has a couple of footnotes. The first one's not that relevant. He was just saying, oh, well, it was probably this other government railroad. And, I mean, we covered that. But the second footnote, libertarians and other free market advocates are divided in their views on patents and other forms of intellectual property, but their logic-chopping style of argument tends to push them to one or the other of the extreme positions, either opposing any patent protection or treating intellectual property similar to other property with no time limits. Do you know any libertarians who take that latter position?
Not even unranded. Seriously. In fact, we've actually been moving much further to the anti-IP position and have been for full on at least a decade now. So what is your current IP?
Yeah, I honestly, the more I see people use IP, you know, especially as a person who does make videos and such, and you know, for, you know, whole fair use and everything, which gets laughed at on YouTube. That's why I have to put my, you know, videos more often than not in other, you know, video sharing sites, HiZipCast. But it just pisses me off about people saying, well, it's property rights and intellectual property is the same. I'm like, no, it's, you know, these things, the intellectual property, for most part, at the end of the day, is someone's property. But again, it's not, you can't steal it. Even if you try to pirate, it's still there. It's still, you know, it's still, you know, it's not someone taking, someone's like, oh, someone stole my iPod or something. Oh, again, I'm sorry, Shane. But if someone stole my iPod, that's, you know, the same thing. Then someone stole property. Some intellectual property, you can't really steal that. It's because you have, again, it's an idea. And a quote, be from that, ideas cannot be, a paraphrase, you cannot kill an idea. You know, you cannot kill or steal or destroy an idea. It still, it grows, and it can grow. And
with another way,
they crush your ideas. Go ahead, Travis.
So put another way, a calculator, well, mine specifically. If I have it, you can have it. If you take it from me, then I don't have it anymore. But, yeah. Whereas if I have... Whereas we can both have the same idea simultaneously, like the idea that I just shared with you. And, yeah, ideas are not scarce the way physical objects are. Get over it, people.
Yeah, and he also talks about, like, that there is a difference between copying and independent invention. But the thing is, I mean, independent invention, okay, you know, someone invents a light bulb, someone else invents a light bulb at the same time. That's okay, but copying is somehow wrong. Well, the only way you can copy an invention is by reverse engineering. And they found out that it actually costs about as much to reverse engineer an invention as it did to put the R&D into inventing it to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not like other people are getting some from nothing here.
I found that some people will try to do when presenting this is they'll only say it only costs, oh, but actually it only costs like 65 or whatever percent as the original R&D. Yeah, because they're not taking into account hiring the scientists and engineers and keeping them trained and up to date with their knowledge. When you add that stuff in, it comes up to 100%, which is what you'd expect.
Yeah.
Yeah, and sadly, no one wants to think about that stuff. And I'll stop my ranting. I do that, people. So when I get on a roll, it's hard to stop. You know.
I noticed.
Well, it's better. Like I said, it's better to keep the go, have it go out instead of just keeping that bottle in. But then I need better self-edit myself. But yeah, this guy, I just don't. Again, I understand where he's coming from, but he just really phrased it in a really wrong way. That's the whole, you know, the whole thing. He just phrased it really.
Well, he doesn't even understand the whole point of the essay, let alone what he's getting wrong in trying to refute it.
Pretty much.
It just says that I love everything that you, the state has done for me, and by God, you love it too, and you know we all need to work together, and yada yada. I'm like, no. I understand some things and things like that, but come on, just give more of like, okay, you know, you didn't need to take down this iPencil to talk about these ideas and such. I mean, use it as a branch of, you know, try to use it as a launching pad, but. It just, you know, the plane just tried to do a launching pad, and instead you pull the launch pad in the crack and just crash it right before you actually took it off the ground. But
does he have any ideas absent his attempts to rebut iPencil? Does he have anything else? I mean, if it weren't for iPencil, what does this have to say?
Nothing. It just says nothing. And, again, he really had a very flimsy life.
Yeah.
Oh, Travis, you're awesome. By the way, don't ever say that, man. You're awesome, man. All right, I got a bug out right quick and everything. Shane, it's been great talking to you.
You can't stay.
No, man. I got other stuff. You know, I got things.
That real life stuff again.
Mm-hmm.
I know that pesky real life stuff. And I'm hungry to get some meat. So, anyway, you two crazy kids have fun. Right.
Okay. Hang on, I'm just going to send out invites again to see if we can get anyone else in here. So.
And as I just said in chat, so when I get a fursuit, I'm so wearing it during a hangout. You'll have a cute tiny golden retriever fur on video.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. All right, well, we got plenty of time. You want to go over some of these comments? We won't go over all of them, of course, but...
Okay. Oh, the comment section. One drink per fallacy, and you'll be dead by alcohol poisoning by midnight.
Okay. Here we go. I'm just going to read this first one here from Freelander. I thought of doing that some time ago. Very good idea, though, given that iPencil is such an amazing work of fiction and shows a total ignorance of how businesses handle their supply chains. Any fool ought to know that a business doesn't, including pencil manufacturers, doesn't just wave a handful of cash in the air with a market prey, wave your money and they will come. to make sure you get exactly the inputs you require to the specifications you require is not a simple matter of the magic of markets. There are all sorts of non-unfettered, whatever that means, market activities helping the whole pencil making magic on its way.
Because as we all know, if government doesn't do it, then it doesn't get done. Am I right?
Well, I mean, he's got it completely backwards. It's not like the business says, we want to make this something. Now we're going to get everyone else to innovate the stuff we need. All those stuff is already innovative. And what the company is doing is basically taking what's there, engineering it, and making something new out of it.
Pretty much.
That's really it. And then once it becomes an established product, then others have the incentive to make better parts of it, better ways to do it. You know, here, let's make it out of, you know, this new type of wood instead of this old type of wood or whatever. Let's use this different material for the eraser, etc.
Yeah, not to mention how, by that logic, then how does he think the iPod or any other new kind of product comes into existence? I mean, there wasn't a demand for those things before they existed. So...
Yeah, so it's just the fact that, you know, people are going to make, they're just making what's demanded for. It's really an evolutionary process, and it kind of reminds me when I made the video about the bacteria that could consume byproducts of nylon manufacture.
Yep.
And it was like the creationists were assuming like you had absolutely nothing, and then ping, all of a sudden you had it there, and then why was it there? Well, and I kept trying to explain to them, it's like, look, this mutation that first allowed them to make nylon probably happened, you know, millions of times before. It's just that there wasn't any nylon around. Now it had an advantage. Yeah. And then after that, it was shored up by additional mutations.
So it kind of his comment then kind of reminds me in that context of creationists will say, like, well, yeah, like I said, you know, how, what do you think that this just poofed into existence? Even though, ironically, that's actually what they're suggesting via creationism, by their God. But, you know, and likewise, what they're expecting to happen via GovCo. Well, the status, I mean. Yeah, you know what I mean.
Yeah, I also see a parallel with intelligent design, where they say, oh, well, you know, if you take out any one part of this, then the whole thing, you know, falls apart and won't work. But, I mean, that's how it happens. You know, you have gene A, you have gene B that mutates or is created to be dependent on gene A. Then gene A now mutates into something else. And then C mutates to be dependent on A and B. And then A and B mutate because they now no longer have to do things that C are doing. And so they all end up being dependent on each other. And it's like this freelander guy is making the same mistake that the creationists make by saying, look, it's all interdependent, therefore it must have been managed from the top down.
Yeah, yet another thing to put in your atheism and libertarianism series if you haven't already.
Oh, I think that's in there, the top down versus bottom up.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's right. Something happened on your end?
No, I'm looking for another comment.
Oh, okay. And she, oh God. Where are these comments?
Yes, all of our viewers are now experiencing dead air while we look for a comment to talk about. A lot of these, I have no idea what they're arguing. Are they for? Are they against? They don't really seem to be able to form a thought.
Oh my god. Yeah, so I'm on my Twitter right now and I'm reading comments from this dude. Yeah, like basically he got fired from his job at the IRS and he's actually pretty ecstatic about it.
Who?
Yeah. A guy on
Who?
Twitter I'm reading the comments
Oh.
of.
Okay, I was looking through this this article, the
Yeah,
comments
not
on the article.
yeah.
Oh, here's a good looking comment from Haiku. Hang on, let me share it again. Haiku up here. So if I mop the kitchen floor, that's a mere activity. But if I pay a cleaner to do it, that's economic activity. I guess that's true if the value of my time is zero, which might be true for certain blog commenters, and possibly quite negative in particular cases of responding to certain blog commenters. SFFTT. So yeah, that's a good point. So, I mean, why would you spend money to hire someone to clean your floor when you can do it yourself? Well, it must be that the time and effort that you would save by not having to mop the floor, you value that more than how much you're paying the cleaner to do it. And that goes into economic concepts like opportunity costs and things like that.
Yeah. And not to mention really basic stuff, like you went over in your basic economics video, the first one, like how, yeah, that's how this stuff works. Voluntary exchange, it has, both parties have to be better off or the transaction will never take place. Yeah, like the Coke example, or in this case, a mop example. Yeah. Although, whatever you do, don't stare at the comments for too long. That will melt your brain, man.
I think I can handle it. I've been on YouTube for how long?
Oh, gee. How you argue with these guys as long as you do, I'll never know. Come
it,
on.
It, it helps to be obsessive and more than a little insane. That's really the recipe there.
Yeah, I suppose. I mean, I can't do it for too long or my damn blood pressure starts going up. Whew.
Okay, this looks like it might be a good one. Hang on, let me share
oh,
it again.
Geez.
You are seeing these screens as I share them, right? They're not just on my screen.
I am, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Just making sure this is the first time I've tried sharing them. So, Jack Strachey talks about, well, what we were talking about, you know, his idea that, oh, this is just market activity and not regular activity. And he says, this is obviously true, and I think we showed that it wasn't. But somewhat misses the point of the libertarian right. Oh, you know it's going to be good after that.
Oh, God.
They are not so much as enamored with market transactions, although they are, as abhorrent towards government authority, especially the power to tax, spend, and regulate according to democratic mandate. Well, you know,
we're
we got a problem with force. That's what it is.
Yeah, I know. We're so unreasonable. We're against things like gang rape, the horror. We're just unreasonable like that.
They regard all private sector non-market transactions, such as household and corporate activity, as ultimately examples, that's horribly worded, of the proprietor's legitimate individual autonomy. They do not regard the sovereign as enjoying comparable legitimate institutional authority. I have no idea what he's trying to say there.
Yeah, I couldn't parse a word of that either.
All right, we'll just skip that one.
Yeah.
Maybe someone in the comments can enlighten us and we can go from there. So ultimately,
yeah.
The libertarian ideological position, by the way, libertarianism isn't an ideology, it's a lack of an ideology, sort of like atheism is a lack of religion. But anyway, is predicated on a view of the legitimacy rather than efficiency of state authority. Well, actually, that's pretty much true. We maintain that the state as an institute of force has not met its burden of proof in showing that it has any legitimacy in acting in the way it does.
I also
really?
Get the nagging wives.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I also... really? So is he seriously trying to tie this into MRA stuff? Oh my god.
Hang on, let me get down there. Really, it ultimately boils down to alpha males ruling their business and home roosts without interference from niggly bureaucrats and nagging wives. What?
Yeah, hence my MRA comment. Also, so why is it not alpha, arrogant, etc. for government to bust down your door and shoot your dog or interfere in your business? Yeah,
yeah, I mean, if anything, guys, it's the intrusion into peaceful voluntary transactions that's the alpha male trying to rule things.
No kidding.
Hence, they are driven to the ideological solution of privatization, which transfers the authority to make command economic decisions from the public to private sector. Of course, this usually ends in economic disaster. Examples? I don't see any. But since the libertarian agenda is primarily driven by non-economic factors, it's not surprising that they stare like zombies at the bitter fruits of their endeavors. Economic rorts are a feature, not a bug, of the privatization program.
Oh, the irony. Said the guy just regurgitating state talking points.
If he was regurgitating points, I think they might be a little more parsable. What are economic rorts?
I mean, you seem to have a bigger vocabulary than me, and mine's nothing to shake a stick at either, so I figured you knew what that meant.
I'm pretty sure it's a typo, but a typo for what? I can't think.
Also, it reminds me of this one dude I met on Twitter talking about how basically who responded to your minimum wage or how to argue for health, universal health care and minimum wage video with, oh, well, it was just opinion, no data, just dogma. Yeah. And then when pressed for evidence, I basically told him, he was like, oh, well, it's just history, and then left it at that, and he called me a troll, because why the hell not?
Yeah.
Yeah, if it's just history, then you should be able to cite quite a few examples and back them up with actual sources. I think you pointed to, like, the 1800s or whatever. Yeah, that horrible time period where the poor improved at the fastest rate ever seen before or since. Funny how
exactly
that works.
Yeah. But it's like, you know, when they talk about privatization, you have things like, okay, we're going to privatize this industry, meaning that we're going to turn it over to this corporation that we're in bed with, give them a monopoly over it, and give them absolutely no accountability and bail them out whenever they do it wrong. And then, of course, everything goes to hell, and they go, see, privatization didn't work.
Yeah, so, oh God, like the so-called deregulation that led to the massive brownouts in California and New York, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, same sort of thing. Mm-hmm. So, and of course...
Yeah, I mean, there were regulations all over the place because there were all these restrictions on building new power plants. There were also restrictions on importing power from other states. And guess who that was passed on behalf of? Can anyone say Enron wanting to secure their profits? Yeah, I think we can probably assume.
And perhaps the most famous example of BS.
Well, hang on.
Sorry.
So what does that do? What does that do? That reduces the supply, so it jacks up the price. But they also put price caps on power delivery to the home. So what happens when you have a price cap and it's below the equilibrium?
Shortages.
Yes, and rolling blackouts and things like that. But no, it's a problem with privatization. You see what the market did?
The horror. And of course, the most famous example of BS deregulation. You know what's common. Well, deregulation caused the banking crisis. Even though I can't point to a single regulation that was repealed without being replaced with something stronger in the federal registry of them. But it's still there because the government says so, so it must be true.
Oh, God. Okay, the irony is strong in this next one. Hang on.
Oh, God. Oh, this should be fun.
Okay, this is agreeing to Jack Strachey's comments we read out earlier. I agree, even if you were being ironic. Libertarianism is about legitimizing self-interest, aggrandizing all wealth and power to specific advantaged individuals while allowing... like government isn't doing that all over the place. Whilst allowing
50% or more millionaires? Sorry.
Whilst allowing all others to be exploited without hindrance. Gotta love that word, exploited.
Oh, God. Buzzwords. Great.
Libertarianism might deny this. Libertarianism doesn't deny anything individual libertarians do, they? But it is the inherent truth in the attempt to minimize the legitimacy of democratic government. In practice, libertarianism equals oligarchy.
In and close with a bold assertion, because that's totally different from what we have now, right?
Yeah. Yeah, so, I mean, where's all these, you know, power to specific advantaged individuals? You mean like Obama's cronies who got an exemption from Obamacare, and now you have unions wanting to be exempt from minimum wage laws?
Or how about the police who regularly murder people? And I swear, it seems like every day I turn, it's like there's another time they murder someone's dog. What is it with them in canines? What the hell? I swear, if they ever read a furry convention, the furries with, like, canine fursuits are better fare for their lives. Like, seriously, Jesus Christ!
Yeah, I think it's just about them being all big and bad, and what they're basically what people accuse libertarians of. Oh, libertarians carry their guns because they're big and bad and want to shoot something. Well, it seems like that's the police to me.
Yeah, projection. More of that.
I think the quality of the comments is like kind of like petering out here as I scroll down.
Well, not that they were really that good to begin with, but
yeah, at least there was interesting things to talk about.
Yeah. All right, while you're looking for that, I have to use the restroom real quick.
Oh, okay. Yeah. You're letting me go solo here. I'm supposed to entertain everyone on myself. I'll just grab my hat and cane and do a little singing and dancing here. Why don't I put this on the screen and you guys can kind of watch me scroll through the comments. Maybe you can, you know, see some that you like that you might want to pause and read and have a laugh at or something. China appears to be running a capitalist economy. Wow. According to who? Wow. People who don't know that China's a communist country, gotta love that. Let's see. I guess he might be considering Hong Kong a part of China. Yeah, you missed
okay,
it.
I'm back.
Yeah, you missed it. I just saw a comment where someone was calling the Chinese a capitalist society.
Good Lord. That's just pitiful. I guess they forgot the part where they're on, like, what is it, 50% or 59-ish percent on the Index of Economic Freedom. Totally capitalist.
Yeah, and I think that we have several of them that are also talking about like the debt and the credit problems with the country and all that, and saying like that's a problem of capitalism too. It's like what? How?
Yeah, how? That's government debt. I mean, yeah. Those governments that incur that, not private individuals. Give me a break.
Come on, give me something quality to tear apart here.
Well, I mean, relatively speaking, with interesting talking. Oh, and Freelander again. Yep. Really? We don't have choice in supermarkets? Funny, even in the ones I go to, I see tons of choices for even different brands of peanut butter, for example.
Oh, God, did you see what Bernie Sanders had to say about that? Like, you've got, like, 23 different kinds of deodorant to choose from when people are starving. It's like, what?
This reminds me of that one relative who would say, no, you must eat your food. Don't you know there are children in China or wherever who are starving? I mean, yeah. It kind of reminds me of that.
And here's one that I think is very easy to answer. Alice says, I don't know how libertarians manage to take solace from the fact that most normal people want a mixed economy and a reasonable government presence when it comes to getting the infrastructure planned and built. Because you're pointing guns at people!
Yeah.
I mean, how hard is this to get through your head?
Well, let me put it this way. Scroll back the clock about 200 years. Replace the word, like, mixed economy with slavery. Yeah, that's what you sound like to us, okay? Oh, by the way, just to let you know, Chris said that he can't join the discussion, and to tell you he's busy with his special sun ponies.
Oh, okay. Yeah, Jacob Morris says he can't make it either because he's at work, so.
Yeah. And he says actually, he can see.
Doing his horrible capitalist activities. I wonder who he's exploiting today.
Wait, he runs a business or something?
Well, he just says he's at work. Okay, he might be a worker, you're right. So he's being exploited right now. I correct myself there.
Yeah. And yes, Chris, I can see that you see me. Since he said I see you, Travis.
Okay, he's viewing?
Yep.
He just can't come on?
Yeah.
Okay, does he want to? I can try and invite him.
He says that he can't join the discussion. He's with his special sun ponies.
Okay.
His words.
All right. Oh, yeah, there's the choice in supermarkets, one that you were talking about. Politics on offer has become much like the choice we have in supermarkets. We get to choose the name of the party in power, but have no choice over policies and government decisions. Whichever brand or differences in packaging stay much the same. Yeah, how many brands of deodorant were there again?
Yeah. No kidding. Because apparently choice is horrible. Mm. And yeah, grief. I swear there ought to be like a law like Murphy's Law or Moore's Law, like that says something like, for every video or article on the internet that allows comments, the comments will always be the worst part of it.
I think that's just life.
Yeah, well, no, that has to be a thing. Like, I'm gonna call them that right now. Yeah,
and that'll be Travis's Law.
True that.
More dead air. Dead air. It's silence, I tell you. It's silence.
Oh, the public law and public service is true enough. Yeah, and they also wanted slavery come 200 years ago. Again, what's the point? Yeah,
the public.
Sorry, morality is not. Yeah,
the public don't care
the morality
about
of an action.
Yeah, go ahead.
Go on, sorry. Okay, then, I mean, it's like, yeah, sorry, but morality is not democratic, nor are facts. I mean, you might as well be saying, oh, well, the majority want creationism taught in the schools. Even if so, who gives a damn?
So the public don't care about the nature of the provision of those services, private or public. They just want the end result. Private companies go bust or rip off the goods and run away all too often. Yeah, and government never does that, right?
Yeah.
Who did Apple rip off or run away from or what? I don't know.
As opposed to the people who in the podcast you and I covered before, who are actually without water.
Yeah. They're probably talking about like Goldman Sachs and people like that, the ones that were shielded from risk by government so they could just do whatever they wanted.
Great. Cronyism, folks. That's cronyism, not capitalism. Oh, and by the way, Chris says he can join now.
Okay. Does he need me to invite him?
He probably does, actually.
Let me see if I can get him. Do I have him in my list? Mm-hmm. And he should be in the... I'll just invite all the co-hosts again. Because I think he's in that list.
Yeah. I mean, I see a...
Yeah, 556 Delta Wolf. That's him. Yeah.
I mean, he should be in the hit. He should have
gotten the invite again. Okay, I'm just going to read some more of this comment here. With the private sector... The public, A, submitted to additional risks concerning the service provision in itself, i.e. continuity of the service provision. Hey, Chris.
Oh, that's Jim. Hi, Jim.
Oh, no, that's Jim.
Hey there.
How you doing?
About ready to go out on my bicycle.
Oh, okay. We're getting the action cam, huh?
Yeah,
and we're also getting feedback.
A couple of weeks ago, I tried actually doing a live stream of my ride, and it worked.
Yeah, I think we're getting echo from you. I think you need to.
Yeah.
Do that.
Yeah, it's probably because I'm outside. Well, I'm about ready to take off here, so if I got time, I'll catch you guys when I get back. All right.
Okay, we'll catch you then.
Alrighty. How do I get out of this thing?
there also seems to be quite a bit of lag on today.
Yeah.
Was there this much lag last time? It didn't seem like there was.
I don't recall that much lag. I don't.
Yeah, but I mean, it's just more blaming the free market for what the government does. I mean, we see that over and over again.
Okay, to be fair, I do like his last sentence. Have a good Easter, everyone, although I don't believe in it, but hey, chocolate. Yeah, great. Chocolate is pretty awesome.
But it's like, the government must be ready to step in when essential services are a threat. Why? Is there not going to be enough market demand for essential services? If there's not, maybe they're not that essential.
No kidding.
For non-essential... Like, no, go ahead.
Yeah, it's like folks, you do not get to claim you know more than people who are in the situation themselves. It's like, seriously, would it kill these people to look up wisdom of crowds and, or at the very least stop being so damn arrogant that they think that they can speak and purport to speak for everyone else? Sheesh.
For non-essential but nevertheless vitally important services, perhaps the government could rely on other private companies stepping in to fill a void, but the political risks in that strategy are severe. But again, wouldn't the demand be there for that? Capitalism does not work by ignoring demand.
It's like, well, first off, they would have to fill a void. Yeah, a void created by government by legally prohibiting people from buying it elsewhere. Also, if that weren't the case, then, well, first off, has this kind of heard of black markets? Like, yeah, no one in the free market sells those kinds of drugs, so surprise, the black market came in to fill the niche. It wasn't even by government. And the worst part is, I'm told that those drugs are actually getting cheaper and relatively safer over time compared to the government stuff, which is actually either stagnant or even getting a bit more expensive, which is just pathetic.
Oh, jeez. Because I think I mentioned this before, the painkillers that I'm taking were put on Schedule 2, which means that every month I have to actually go into my doctor's office. And the doctor actually has to fill out a new prescription, and then I have to get it for the people. And I mean, that's all that labor they pay to do that. That's all the stuff I go through to get that. I have to take it to the pharmacy to myself and pick it up. And not only that, I mentioned that before, but what I just found out is now I have to go back and get a doctor's appointment every 3 months to get that updated, because if it takes longer than that, then apparently the FDA doesn't like it. And so now, here I am, not insured, can't afford anything on the exchange, even though I had affordable insurance before Obamacare. Thanks, Barry.
Thanks, Barry.
But now I got to do another, you know, I just had to do it last week. And God, after the whole thing, after paying the doctor's office and getting the medicine and everything, because he also put me on some new painkillers, which are hopefully going to work better and result in me taking less hydrocodone. It's actually a neurological painkiller, which is more the kind I might need. But after doing all that, it was a good $200.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Like, to give you an idea, even the generic for my medication, I think it's called a Lexapro. I'm taking the generic kind, but I'm not even going to try to pronounce that name. Without a without my crappy state insurance or whatever it is covering it, it would cost me like over $100 for 30 pills. And yeah, I think it's a controlled substance like you, where every month I have to go to the doctor or to my psychiatrist. He fills out, I take about 5 minutes to say, yeah, I'm fine. I just need to refill my prescriptions. He writes it. I'm out. I reschedule for another month. I then have to go to the pharmacy and basically cross my fingers that they won't give me any trouble saying, oh, yeah, but we don't accept this stuff anymore for your insurance or whatever. And then go in, wait for the prescription, and then bring it back, which is just, it's just mindless, pointless busy work. It's annoying. And the worst part is that's usually the best scenario. If they don't accept it, oh, that's when the real fun begins. Then it's spending hours with the pharmacist talking with them or getting them to call Medicaid or whatever.
Oh, that was another thing with this new painkiller. Even though it's not addictive or on the schedule or anything like that, it was still mandatory that I do a consultation with the pharmacist, only for the pharmacist to go over what the doctor had already told me about the medicine.
Yeah. I mean, it's like people talk about how, you know, big pharma and how it's bad and it kills people, to which I say, yes, but not in the way that the conspiracy mongers are probably thinking. I still remember that figure you told me from Mary J. Ruart in the second edition of her book, Healing Our World, where she pointed out that because of their denial of life-saving medication to people who probably could have needed it, with the efficacy testing they do, it's... Even at the time of writing her book, which is, I think it was like in 2001-ish, it's costed about over 4 million people their lives. I'm sure that's probably a lot higher by now.
By the way, is the Q&A app working for you? If you click on the Q&A button over on the left side?
That is a good question. Hold on. And I think it's loading. Ask questions to submit. Yeah, sure. Audience, submit questions.
Okay. Because I'm just getting a black list there. If you see anyone post questions, let me know. It's not working on my end.
I see one. I see one from Forrest Murdoch, and he says, and he seems to be adding to my comment, or the deregulation of the airline industry in 1978.
Okay. Which comment do you think that was applying to?
I think it was the one that you and I were talking about, deregulation, like, of the power companies and that leading to rolling blackouts.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
What's there?
All right. Well, yeah, everyone, if you want to post a question in the Q&A app, please do so. It's just that Travis will have to relay them to me, apparently. It's not loading on my end. So let me know when someone posts something there.
Yeah. Okay, question, answer questions. Yeah, so far it's just that. Oh, wait. When are you guys going to invite me from Doll to Wolf?
I just did! Hang on. Let me...
I mean, I thought I tried to tell them that you have to join the video itself, like, manually.
Boom. I just sent him another invite.
Grief. Yeah. And he says...
You can get a third person in here, and then you can two can talk while I scroll through more of these comments.
Yeah.
A lot of these now are just back and forth stuff, people talking to each other.
Yeah. All right. So, it looks like...
Oh, here's an interesting one. Let's take a look at this one. Hang on.
Ooh, this should be fun.
All right. Freelander again.
Oh, cool, boy. He's our highballer right now.
Okay. They both produce stuff people want, and stuff people don't want. Interestingly, the public sector is frequently there to save the private sector's bacon. When Iceland had its volcanic eruption, it was the public sector that shut the airlines down. They certainly would have done it themselves. How does he know that?
Apparent statist, thinking they're psychic.
Oh, there's Dave! I didn't think it was Dave!
My phone.
Yeah. Yeah, we're talking about the crazy comments on this John Quiggin essay. We finished the essay about 45 minutes ago.
Yeah, I saw that,
but I was like, I gotta get in on this.
Oh, God. Yeah. Oh, hey, Dave, I didn't know you wore glasses. Cool.
Yes, I do.
Once again, government and its regulators have saved an industry from destroying itself. In the process of destroying itself, the airline industry would have produced plenty more of a product the public doesn't want. Non-arrival at your flight destination due to your flight terminating short and somewhat abruptly. In other words, if it weren't for wonderful, beneficent, omnipresent government, planes would just be crashing right and left all over the place because the airline companies are just completely bad at managing risks, I guess.
Can you guys hear me?
Hey, yep, I hear you, Chris. Yeah. I don't
Chris.
See you.
Finally. Yeah. Sorry.
By the way, I'm not coming in all echoey, am I?
Coming in what?
Like with echoes?
I'm not hearing
you're
any.
Not. You're good.
Yeah. Okay. Well, like I said, I'm on my phone, so.
Oh. No, Dave, you're a lot more handsome in real life.
Oh. Okay.
Just playing with the man.
Travis likes Dave. Yeah. Travis likes Dave.
That wasn't me. That was Chris.
That was me.
Oh,
yeah.
Sorry. Chris,
it's okay. I've already got two lovers. I got a boyfriend and a girlfriend. So yeah, I'm a polygamist. Sue me.
Double your pleasure, double your fun.
Yeah. I don't get the war on polygamy. In all honesty, like I see these Christians walk around saying polygamy's evil. So what? If all parties are consenting to it, who cares?
Yeah.
Well, since we're not married, that would actually technically be polyamory, but potato, potato.
Yeah, because polygamy is specifically one man, multiple wives, and polyandry is one wife, multiple husbands, so I guess what'd you call it, polyamory, I guess would be the generic term that...
I think it's called being polymerous or something. I'd have to look it up. But yeah, something like that. Basically, it's more than two mutual lovers. But not out of class.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm in an interrogation room with this one light above me.
I originally wasn't going to join, but then I saw there were so many stupid questions that some of these pro-mixed government people were saying I had to join.
So not this Freelander guy. Oh, God.
Yeah.
Freelander again. Going back to what we were saying about the Icelandic planes, of course they have financial incentives to avoid airplane crashes, but so do problem gamblers have financial incentives not to lose all their money by feeding pokey machines. Both problem gamblers and the people who run airlines are punks who feel they are lucky. Unfortunately, the result is unlikely to make the travel going public's day. It's like, what?
What the hell is that guy's problem? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I get it.
I feel like there's an old man running this
fucking punk.
Yeah,
but I mean, it's like he talks about problem gamblers who are people with a mental illness or some other kind of. Neurological problem, and the gambling addiction is just a symptom of that. What does that have to do? I mean, one thing I know about airlines, everything that happens on an airplane is the decision of the pilot. He is the captain, and even if the airline company says go fly, if he doesn't think it's safe enough to go fly, he can say no, it's not happening, it's too dangerous.
Yeah.
He gets the last word on all of that.
And it's funny that he brings up gambling because government seems to be the biggest gamblers. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And from what I understand, that the Iceland volcano was only a problem for planes that were traveling in certain directions anyway.
Yeah.
But I mean, they grounded all of them, so. Yeah.
Kind of reminds me of this one guy who I once met who swears that free market capitalism and all is the cause for all the earthquakes and volcanoes, and I'm like, how?
Seriously?
Yeah, it's like, okay, I can understand, you know, I can kind of sort of see the argument for global warming, but volcanoes and earthquakes are caused by Earth's crust movements. You know,
who the fuck said this?
I'm even going to make a case against the global warming thing, because the biggest driver of global warming is the fact that we're driving our cars gasoline-powered, and what's everyone's big question about government? You know, without government, who would build the roads? Well, what are roads except one huge subsidy to the automobile industry?
Yep. Also, here's the thing. Here's the thing. I actually met a coworker today at work who she was watching the news on her phone, and, you know, we did get a brief conversation about government, and, you know, she was complaining about how the government was forbidding certain people from buying, like, certain foods on their food stamps, and she's wondering what the heck's going on, and I just jokingly replied, "Well, that's the government," and he goes, "No, it's our problem, because we didn't vote properly." Yeah. I didn't comment any further, because I didn't want to start an argument there, but I'm just thinking, what options do we have, you know?
You should have. Anybody who's dumb enough to say that deserves the fight.
Yeah.
Jeez. Yeah, but he doesn't want to get fired or anything either. It wasn't work.
Yeah.
This is what I'm talking about, so.
But yeah, you know, it's like, look, governments, you know, just because you don't get, we control the government. I'm just thinking, no, you don't. The only thing you control is how they get into power, but once they get into power, they do whatever the hell they want.
If we control the government, why is the NSA spying on us?
Yeah.
No kidding. Yeah. Well, if that's the case, then why is the tax code so complicated? I mean, what, because we all love it that way? Give me a break.
Okay, here's another comment. Here's a comment from Chris Warren. I don't think we've read one of his yet, but it's like, and I'm not sure, I haven't clicked this link to see what he's talking about, but it's like,
I've seen his comment. He is ashamed to have the name Chris.
And here we see American capitalism trying to work up enough courage to give themselves the mother of all bailouts and the
tunnels. That's government!
What happens if the debt ceiling isn't raised?
Oh, my God. Says,
at this stage, this is all they can do, as solutions to previous structural crises, such as war and empire building, are no longer available.
Government!
Of course, piling on more debt, this only delays the day of reckoning. Tough luck, capitalism.
Again,
you keep using that word. I do not think it means what you think it means.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Yes, speaking of that empire building, I actually saw a person who kept arguing with me saying, like, he brought up the banana wars from the 1920s, saying that was caused by capitalism, and I'm like, yeah, and whose decision was it to deploy the U.S. Marines into South America? Was it Chiquita Banana? Did they hire the Marines? No, it was the government. The only thing Chiquita Banana did was they went to the government and said, hey, these South American revolutionaries are attacking our places and we don't know what to do. And the government said, well, we can't let that happen. We're going to send Marines and we're going to kill them all and force them to buy American products. That's
I'm Chiquita Banana, and I'm here to say we're going to get our guns and blow you away.
Again, but who has control over the United States Marines? It's not Chiquita Banana. Well, at the time they were called the United Food Corporation, but...
Well, yeah, we know what you mean.
Yeah, but
you don't need to give conspiracy theorists any ammunition. Next thing you know, instead of lizard people, it's going to be banana people.
Yeah, I know. I'm just going to say this. I honestly hate people, you know, who claim capitalism, Curry, you know, causes wars, because when I ask them, why do you believe that? Says, well, because look who benefits off wars, the weapon manufacturers and all that. And I'm like, yeah, but who decides, let's use the weapons? You know,
or who buys those weapons?
Lockheed Martin can sell all the F-22s and F-35s they want, but that doesn't mean they have the right to say, okay, you're going to buy them and you're going to use them, so you got to attack a random country. They don't do that.
Guys, I have to come clean. I'm actually responsible from my basement for deploying the weapons. I'm responsible. I run the New World Order from this basement.
Yeah.
You did 9/11, too?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, you did 9/11. I assassinated Archduke Franz Ferdinand. Beat that.
Oh, I got that beat. I committed the Great Train Robbery.
I can beat that.
That was me. There's a movie about that.
I can beat that. I once put thousands of rat infected rats onto and wiped out a quarter of Europe.
I can beat that. I was the one who trained the Mongols and got them to destroy about a sixth of the world's population.
No, we're
going to
know.
Oh, you were the one that got them to bust down my shitty wall? You were the one who sent the Mongols to bust down my shitty wall?
Hey, I'm the one who trained
Mongolians? Goddamn Mongolians!
And caused the Roman Empire to fall.
Goddamn Mongolians, cracking my shitty wall!
And then after the Mongolians comes Japan. That's actually a joke I actually thought of doing, you know, my own parody of that, where after the Mongolians, he go, it's like, okay, we're all done now. Then all of a sudden he hears, tally-ho, that's, what, the British? Oh, come on. Yeah, then it's the Japanese and the North Koreans attacking, and he goes, oh, come on, that war hasn't even happened yet. Yeah.
By the way, I posted in the group chat, not on the Hangout, but on this video, the word you were looking for. It was like a polyamorous.
Polyamorous, I think is the word.
Yeah.
Polyamorous.
Yeah, I think it is. Yep.
All right. Okay, so this is from Alice. Have we read... there have been several comments from Alice, but I don't remember if I read any of them.
I don't think you have, no. This is the first.
Those that want to diminish government and government intervention are doing untold damage to all whilst cleaning their teeth with clean, regulated water and convincing themselves and trying to convince the rest of us they did it all on their own and they don't need government intervention because they had to get up to go to get a job and look after themselves. Hey, I'm brushing my teeth with clean, unregulated water. I have a well.
Here.
Yeah, it's like...
Nice from the comfort of your clean regulation protected world to say you now never needed government protection because you had the guts and smarts to make it on your own without government protection and government regulation, some of which was pretty hard to get past in history in a government protected world. Dare I say it, complete idiots.
90% of history's problems were caused by government.
Yeah, so basically probably a fan of Mr. You Didn't Build That either, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Or that one sounds like basically it, yeah, you didn't.
Or that one historian who wrote like this long essay where he kept insisting that the Civil War was all about liberating slaves and that the South seceded only because they wanted to keep the slaves.
That was true of like three or four of the states, but not the rest.
Yeah, that was like... Yeah, I know. He only used the declaration from one state, but nothing else, you know.
Isn't it interesting about how all these hangouts we somehow end up talking about the Civil War?
Yeah.
Yeah. That is a great debate because I've seen some people say, well, if it was for you limited government, if it wasn't for big government, the United States would be divided. And I just want to argue saying, hey, if the government stayed out of other people's business, there wouldn't have been a Civil War.
No kidding.
And people respond, but then who would have freed the slaves? It would have gone away on its own.
As it did in just about every other country. Yes, also, someone has a lot of that.
Seriously, out of all the countries that ended slavery, how come the United States was the only one that had to kill millions of people to do it? You know, I mean, look at England. England ended slavery rather peacefully. Brazil ended slavery rather peacefully. How come the United States had to kill so many people to end something like that?
Yeah, the rest of these comments are pretty much ad hominem attacks. People saying you didn't ad hominem attack, and the other person saying it wasn't an ad hominem after one. You know how that goes, back and forth like that. So I think we're done with this.
There's enough drugs in the world to get me fucked up enough to even want to read something like that.
There aren't enough drugs in the world to do that to me, yeah.
All right, who's got another topic?
Not me.
I got a topic.
Come on,
pancakes.
I can't shut you up the rest of the time. Then when we get done with this, I can't get you to talk. Dave, what's pulling your trigger lately?
Pancakes.
Come on, you're the trigger man. You're the trigger man. You're outrageous.
I gotta come up with something that's pissing me off now. Oh God.
Well, it's better to be pissed on.
Oh, well, oh God.
It's so older than the hairs on my grandfather's
you're
teeth.
Water sports.
Yeah. God,
seriously, Travis, why are people attracted to that on the Furry Fandom? There's so many people attracted to that stuff.
No, let's not talk about that.
Yeah,
I'm going to scroll back up our Skype discussion because there was some stuff you were talking about earlier. Let's see.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Didn't the government try to regulate that kind of porn like a few years ago? Like extreme, quote unquote, they tried to ban quote unquote extreme porn, you know, like like they tried to ban, you know, the best way I could put it, the more kinky stuff, you know, like they thought that was bad for moral or something.
Listen, for some reason, Shane's turning into me at a couple of times during, I don't know, it's funny. It looks weird on my phone. Suddenly, I show up where he's supposed to be.
I'm taking over. Okay, guys, I admitted Dave Turcotte is really me. Yep.
That's
all a conspiracy.
Pay no attention to the mustache guy with glasses behind me. Nobody sees the great Dave Turcotte.
I'm going to tell a funny story about my last name. My last name is spelled T-U-R-C-O-T-T-E. And all my life, I've had people come up with the most asinine pronunciations of my name. Okay, take a guess at some of the ones that you would expect.
Turcotte?
Turcotte?
Yeah. Yep. Turcotte?
I'm drawing a blank. I think I got it right the first time, didn't I?
It's Turcotte.
Yeah, Turcotte.
But I've gotten Turcotte. I've gotten Turcotte. I've gotten Turcotto.
Turcotto?
I've gotten...
Wasn't that the guy who married Lucy?
That's Ricardo.
Ricky Turcotto?
Ricardo. Actually, his real name was Denny something...
Arnaz or something.
It was Desi Arnaz.
Oh yeah, he was a popular Cuban American singer in the '50s.
Yeah.
But I can get Turcotte and some of those, but like Turcotte?
What are you, Canadian? Turcotte?
I'm actually French Canadian.
Oh, hey, which... are you from one of the Newfoundland Turcotte's, eh?
Yeah. I'm not your buddy, guy. Seriously, we gotta get Tim on here so we can make fun of his Canadian accent.
Most Canadians don't have an actual Canadian accent.
Yeah.
I know. I live in Wisconsin. We have a lot of Canadians here.
I'm actually like a mutt for the most part. My father's side is French Canadian. My mother's side is Italian, Irish, German. There's Syrian in it.
Let me guess. Their family was sailors.
No. I looked at my family's shield. My family's shield sucks. It's a sheep.
So something tells me the cooking on your mother's side of the family is pretty good.
Eh. My grandmother on my mother's side, yes. My mother, not so much.
Well, yeah. I mean,
yeah, in our household. But
yeah, I'm kind of a mutt too. Although my primary ancestors came from Germany.
You want me to make a prime rib? It ain't happening. But I'll make you an egg sandwich.
Cooking. I'm about a quarter Japanese. About a big chunk of me is
that explains
like from
the
UK.
Eyes.
Chris, you're killing.
Sorry, I'm an amateur stand-up comic, so.
Yeah, I'm also about a quarter, Serbian or whatever from my dad's side. Yeah. And I actually have a little bit of an Italian from my mom. You can figure.
Your parts
Serbian? I think I only have one line that I know of that isn't German, and it's Scots-Irish.
Yeah, I think I'm looking for a name, and I think it said it was like Irish
German,
or something.
Swiss German, yeah. Czech.
Yeah, I think I actually have some. What is that called? Like some Scandinavian, I mean, like Norwegian or something, or Swedish.
Oh, I'm actually descended from King Odin.
Although, to
of course,
be fair,
there are probably a billion other white guys in the world, but yeah. Those Scandinavian kings got around. If you're white, sit back, there's probably a line going.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't be surprised if I did my thorough history. If you, yeah, I'm pretty sure most people, if you do thorough history, you'll probably find out you are related to royalty some way or another.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was thinking it back through. I think it was the Norwood. I had some Norwoods up in there, and the Norwoods took me back to England. And then all of a sudden, I was going through, and then I was typing in the names of earls and barons and stuff like that in England. And then all of a sudden, I was typing in all these Scandinavian names, and then all of a sudden it was, you know, such and such, you know, King of Norway, such and such, King of Norway, King of Norway, King of Norway, and then all the way back to Siggy Fridolfsson, known as King Odin, the first king of Scandinavia.
Oh, my friend Jason discovered he was a descendant of a German prince, apparently. He was doing his family history because his family likes to keep their history for some reason, and after doing some thorough investigation, they found out that one of his grandfathers on his paternal mother's side of the family is a descendant of I don't know what title it was, but he was some earl from some prince or earl from Prussia.
Yeah,
I know my mother's side.
I've had troubles in like I'm from German Killians. I'm from Hagers, who are German, Siffords, who are German, and several German lines. But the problem is, I get back so far and I keep hitting a wall because so many records were destroyed in the 30 Years' War that it's really difficult to get past that.
Oh, yeah, going back to my friend, you know, that's actually his paternal side of the family doesn't know much about their side because their record, family records, a lot of them were destroyed during the Franco-Prussian War.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I know on my mother's side, she had an ancestor who was on the Titanic. That's about the extent.
Oh, did she die? Or was rescued?
I don't know of any ancestors I have, so yeah, my ancestry is pretty boring.
If you want to trace it back, I forget the name of the website, but the Mormons are really, really big into genealogy, and they have a genealogy website that is just completely free, and you can just look through all their records and find out all sorts of stuff.
My friend Jason also has a neighbor, you know, who he's not Mormon now, but he's a distant relative of Joseph Smith, and like, you're a distant relative of Joseph Smith, and he replied, well, yeah, he had like four wives, so yeah, so
he had as many kids as all the Scandinavian kings. That's how prolific he was.
Yeah,
I also know that my last name, Turcot, the prefix Turk, obviously from Turkey, when I did a little bit of research on that, the origin comes from people who traveled to you know, that area during the Crusades.
Yeah,
and there was a lot of nobility.
Oh.
But I don't know from which or to what extent.
Yeah. I found out the meaning behind my last name. Apparently my last name, Hangartner, is a very, very, very old term for a person who comes from the small village of Hangart, which is a teeny tiny little province it's not a province, it's like a village-like area in northern Germany.
Yeah, see, usually the southern German that ends with R means you're from there. You know, like the hamburger originated in Hamburger. The wiener, the hot dog, was from Vienna, which they call Wien. So if it ends in ER, that usually means it's someone or something from that place.
Oh, so a wiener was named after Vienna. Hmm.
Yeah.
Well, that's because people forget to realize that in Germany, a W is pronounced a V, you know.
Yeah.
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 Yeah, that's why I laugh when people who refer to Germany, you know, between World War I and World War II call it the Weimar Republic. It's the Weimar. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, and like Frankfurter is from Frankfurt and things like that. Yeah, if it's ending in ER, it means it's from that place.
Yeah. Oh, and contrary to popular belief, the Dachshund was not named after the hot dog. It was actually vice versa. Yeah, believe it or not.
Yeah, to this day I still refuse. To this day I still refuse to put my real life real name online. At least, you know. Yeah.
Why are you afraid? Are you afraid the liberals are gonna come after you?
Yeah, it's just not something I want. Like people who apply for a job, I don't want them to see the other kinds of things there.
Yeah, that's something that's actually becoming an issue. People are finding that like employers are looking at their Facebook pages and if they see something they don't like.
A lot of people, what they recommend is that you make two accounts, one for personal use and one for business, but
It seems so easy.
But I mean,
they even
look at the personal one because they look for your name.
Yeah.
They even look at the personal one and try and dig up dirt on yours.
That's why I use a pseudonym. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm sure they can still find it out.
Accept friend requests from people you don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And usually I have my stuff set on so that only my friends can see what I put, so.
Yeah. I've totally screwed myself. Everything's public. It's all public.
I mean, generally speaking, you know, obviously companies should be allowed to hire whoever they want. But at the same time, I'm going to have my opinions. If you don't like them, tough shit. You know? As far as I'm concerned, they're not really business. Unless I'm threatening to kill people, then fuck off.
Yeah, it's like, even then, you know, the government can't always tell. Like, you know, they've been known to arrest people who have, like, said, I'm going to, like, blow up the entire world, even though it's pretty obvious from the comment that it's a joke or sarcastic, you know.
Yeah.
What about that one woman who the cops stole her phone, and then made that fake Facebook page for her, and even posted things like news. Imagine if they do something like that. A prospective employer sees that there's the, because she didn't know about that page for years.
People blame Facebook for stuff that the government causes.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's like the whole Amtrak situation. I mean, I just posted that story earlier about how if you count inflation, they had $7 billion in subsidies, and yet not a single year of profits. And with all the crap that's been happening with them, stuff that has been deadly, and yet some people are still convinced we need to give them more money because they're a public sector, but if they were a private sector, well, we'd be having their heads on spikes.
It's the special pleading.
I mean, for me, not just knowing about my politics, but also the RA stuff, that's not really something I'd want an employer to know. At least, you know, not at first.
But
like
the interesting
that thing
about Amtrak, when you're talking about Amtrak, remember like a year or two ago, I think, on the podcast, we were covering about how they couldn't even run a snack bar at a profit.
Oh, wow.
How terrible do you have to be
you can't run a snack bar
at a profit?
You can't even sell chips and soda pop, and we're trusting these people to run public transit.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, come on, at least a carnival can serve me a good corn dog to compensate for the fact that I'm sitting there watching a terrible clown and a bad comedian. Yeah.
All right, well, anyways, I'm pretty exhausted with this. I'm going to go. It was fun, guys.
So, all right, I think we're probably winding down. I thought I'd finish up just by kind of giving everyone kind of a little heads up at what we're going to be covering on the podcast. I think Charles and I are going to be doing it unless...
Oh, speaking of which, Shane, I would like to tell you this in case of the future, but I got my computer cleaned up, and the guy who cleaned up my computer, he removed my BitTorrent, so, and he advised me not to re-upload it, so.
Well, it depends on which one you use.
Not to re-upload what? Not to re-upload what?
BitTorrent, the BitSync or whatnot, the one I used to give you the stuff. He says it's too dangerous, apparently.
How is BitTorrent Sync dangerous?
I don't know. He said it lets other people get my stuff, and I kind of told my mom, you know, I mean, that's kind of what I use it for. I use it so I can give you my podcast information.
But it's only people you share it with. So it's like you and me and the other co-hosts can access our special little BitTorrent Sync directory and get all the audio together for the podcast. Yeah. No one else can access that. No one else can get into your...
Yeah, I mean, the guy who fixed my computer, he's
just trying to scare you.
Yeah. Well, he's a genius with computers, but he kind of has, like, this great mistrust of stuff like torrents and VPNs and all that.
And not know of something's existence.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, okay, I definitely going to be on the podcast this week, just because I'll be at a furry convention, so, yeah, my first one, too.
Coming up, there was actually a break-in into the IRS records, and hackers got a lot of personal stuff from taxpayers, so we'll be talking about that. We'll be talking about how it's actually possible to hack into a surgery bot, because they've got these things now where they can do surgery by remote, and so there's another security issue there with these surgery bots.
Jesus.
We're going to be talking about or about movie studios and video on demand services and a lot of the dirt behind that. And we're also going to be covering some more Gamergate criticism. We'll have a biggest Bogon emitter and an idiot extraordinaire as well. And we'll also have another Silver Clue on. So that'll all be this week.
Yeah, Silver Clue on, those are rarely given.
Usually about four or five a year.
I have a quick question about like Silver Clue ons. So why is it silver and not gold? I mean, is that, I was assuming that it was like maybe a reference to something, or
I just thought it sounded better. It doesn't actually exist, you know. It's not actually a thing. So.
Yeah. But no. My favorite Silver Clue on rewards.
I still think you should have a Gold Clue on as like the end of the year award.
Yeah.
For like the best thing said all year.
Yeah. My favorite Silver Clue on winners were those scientists who got you know, just that long memo saying, get me off your fucking mailing list on a magazine website. I actually
got it past peer review. All it was. Over and over, get me off your fucking mailing list. Get me off your fucking mailing list.
I actually saw a period where it was showing like these advanced civilization like in the year like 3750 AD, and it's like, and here we have found an ancient archival record which we believe might have been some sort of a complex mathematical equation. We have yet to translate, though, and all it is saying, get me off your fucking mailing list. they think it's some sort of ancient scientific calculus problem.
Yeah.
Well, I think the lesson with that is you better get off the fucking mailing list.
Yeah, that was all because...
Definitely don't publish it.
Yeah, and that was all because that one scientific magazine kept, you know, owning them, right? Like, that's what was going on?
Well, that's what it was initially, and that was something they did just to kind of automatically send to the people who were kind of harassing them for it. But what got the Silver Clue on was someone actually used it to get one of these... There's a whole bunch of new open... journals, which I mean, I think that's a good idea. I mean, there are a lot of good ones. Like, I think PNAS is an open journal, but there's a lot of them. Yeah, I forget, what does this stand for? I forget what it stands for. PNAS. But anyway, no, not PN. No. Get mine out of the gutter, Travis. Okay. But yeah, there's a lot of them that are just like set up. Well, like there's that woman that set up one just so she could publish her Bigfoot DNA article, things like that. And so he's kind of just wanting to see, it's like, what kind of stuff will they accept? And so he sent it to them, and they said, oh, well, we went through the peer review, and we accepted it, and all you have to do is pay us $500 or whatever, and they'll publish it. And so he didn't pay it, and so they didn't actually publish it, but... I think it would have been funny to get a Kickstarter together for the purpose of paying the money to publish it and then have that actually published in the journal.
And it's funny you go back to Bigfoot DNA, because I saw this fun documentary about Bigfoot, and like they found like an alleged sample, and the science tested, and they said, well, in all honesty, we don't know what it is. It's inconclusive. And they're like, ah, that's a sign that it must be Bigfoot.
It just means that it's a contaminated sample. I mean,
yep, that's what they theorized.
Actually, guys, every Bigfoot sighting, that was me.
Hey, it was later proven that the famous Bigfoot...
Hey, somebody's got to make the Senate.
Yep.
That's not Bigfoot, that's just Dave Turcotte.
Yeah, the guy who filmed it. Dave could dress in a gorilla suit.
Yeah, they have...
That's the closest you'll ever see me being in a fursuit, just for the record.
I'm trying to remember what it was. It was either... There was something the guy wrote to be published posthumously to say, or the guy he faked it with after his death. Somehow after the guy died, it came out.
Yeah, the guy who faked it. Yeah, the guy who helped faked it revealed it because they interviewed the guy who was in the costume, and they asked him, well, why did you swear the secret to your best friend? And they said, because they said if I did this, they'd pay me $1,000, and they didn't pay me.
Hush money only works if you actually give them the hush money.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah, he said that in the interview. If they would have paid me that $1,000 they owed me, I would have kept my mouth shut.
Well, bye-bye. That's a thing. See ya. I need to be in bed.
All right, good night, Travis.
Bye.
Yeah, there's a lot of videos and there's a lot of videos and pictures out there that people think are real but are actually hoaxes when you actually think about them.
Yeah.
There was actually one funny picture that was from like 1930 or something that everyone keeps saying there's a time traveler in there because there's just one guy who's wearing sunglasses and it's like they had sunglasses back in those times, people.
Oh, there's one that's supposedly a time traveler because he's holding up what looks like a cell phone. I'm like, they didn't have cell phones back then. And it's like, okay, A, there were no cell phones, so there were no cell phone towers, so who was he talking to?
Yeah.
And B, it ended up being a hearing aid because they couldn't make the hearing aids compact enough then to go in the ear, and
yeah,
it was a hearing aid.
Yeah. Yeah, it's
all right, anything else anyone wants to talk about before we sign off for the night?
Pancakes. Sorry.
I'm going to shill if you don't.
Is that the word for today, pancakes? You're expecting a duck to fall down with pancakes?
Yeah, I saw the movie Cabin Fever. That's shell. A really crappy movie. Apparently the guys who made Cabin Fever don't know the difference between a flesh-eating illness and a hemorrhaging one.
Huh.
Yeah, like whatever it's called.
Okay, yeah, so wrapping this up, I'm going to chill a little bit. Yep. I don't know if you guys like video games out there. If you do, over on my website, superplexbros.com, we're going to do a month or 3 months of classic gaming for Summer of Classics. Cool. News, top lists, narrative pieces, retrospectives on old school games. And I'm also doing Let's Plays on my personal YouTube channel, Iron Fury, to go along with that. So feel free to check all that out.
Okay.
And also, if you like Dave's stuff, he has a Patreon account. Go check that out, too.
Okay.
Yeah, check that out, please. I need money.
Yeah,
hey, look,
don't you...
as soon as Travis left, my Q&A window came up, so I can see what everyone's saying in there now.
I'm broke.
Bob976... Does Killian, are you aware of Harry Brown's widow writing his biography? Do you know anything about her progress? I don't have any sort of updates on that, but that's something I'm really looking forward to. I've been meaning to try to get... she published what he had written on the war racket. I've been trying to get my hands on that, but I don't know any updates about the biography. It'll be awesome, though, when it comes out.
Well, I'm going, guys.
All right. Night-night. Hey, anything else, Dave, before we sign off?
No. I shield. Okay. That was good.
All right. Well, it's our very unorganized, unceremonious end to our second hangout. Hopefully, there's Jim again.
Hello, right hello. Can you
of course. Last minute.
Ah.
Sweet.
We were treated to a few seconds of his bike cam a little bit ago while he was getting ready to go.
Yeah.
Good bike ride?
Of course.
Yeah, I'm so out of shape. I was like, this last year I didn't.
Damn it, Jim! You messed everything up.
Well, that's just exactly what I do.
I mean, like 10 seconds later, you would have missed us. We were signing off.
Oh, jeez. Yeah, I figured I got to get out and mow the lawn, but I need to rest a little bit before I do that. So I figured I'd see if you guys are still on.
Yeah, we're just signing off, so...
Well, all right.
We've got like 5 minutes, I think, if there's anything you want to talk about, right?
No, not really. I posted something up on my Facebook page earlier and about the minimum wage going to $15, and this guy who's on my friends list who I think, because he's a member of a anti-conspiracy group that I'm in,
he was like,
well, I own a small business, and I pay my employees
like
double the minimum wage is now, and I think every business can afford it. And I'm like thinking, oh God, here we go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What kind of business is it?
I did not ask him, because frankly, I wasn't very interested.
Because if he's like hiring nuclear scientists or something like that, I would expect him to be paying them more than minimum wage. So.
Oh, you would think. But yeah, and I posted this on an atheist skeptic page the other day. It's like, I'm just really getting tired of seeing all of these skeptical and atheist groups out there that are like all like left-wing Democrats. And I'm like, if these people were as skeptical as they say they are, they'd at very least be members of the Green Party. Yeah. I don't know.
I have never had good experience discussing politics on Skeptics Board. They throw it all out the window when it comes to politics.
Yeah, fortunately there's a skeptical libertarian group on Facebook, but
yep.
I don't know. If you're not a member of it, you should check out the group Chemtrails Are Killing Us. It actually at one time was a pro-chemtrail group, but it got taken over by a bunch of anti-chemtrailers.
All right, fellas, so I think I'm going to boogie.
All right,
see you, Dave.
See ya.
See you later.
Pro-chemtrail people keep coming in there thinking it's a pro-chemtrail group.
Get off this goddamn thing.
And so it's like trolling without even trolling. So that's always very fun. And they come up with the best memes on that group. Oh, jeez. I have a lot of fun in that group. It's apparently the only conspiracy, anti-conspiracy group you need if you just want to have a good time and mocking people mercilessly. Boy, do I love mocking chem sheep.
Okay.
It's gotten to the point where conspiracy people call people that don't believe in them believe in conspiracy sheep so much that I always strike first and call them the sheep.
Oh, I think it was a Reputation Anti-Vaccine Memes that posted this. There's a picture of a sheep with a tinfoil hat on.
Uh-huh.
And I forget exactly what it said, but it was something like, you know, believes every single thing they read on conspiracy sites, calls other people a sheep.
Yes. Yeah, I've created a few of those. I did create one image, and I got to dig it up. It's on, I think, my laptop, where these people pretty much parrot the likes of Mercola and Alex Jones and all that, but they're also sheep. And so I created a meme image of a pair of sheep. Head of a parrot body of a sheep. So, but one thing okay.
Hang on. Hob976 says the War Ranked books are out on Kindle. I guess that I prefer EPUB, so I didn't really. I guess I'll have to check that out though. And there's a transcript of his Rule Your World seminar. It's sweet. So thanks, Hob976. We'll check that out.
Who was that? Or whose book was that?
Harry Brown's.
Oh, okay, cool. Yeah.
The War Ranked.
Oh man, one other thing, real quick, and it just occurred to me this morning. I posted it, I think, first thing on Facebook this morning. When you're talking about Oz or Wakefield or Mercola or anything, don't call him Doctor. Don't give him the dot. Don't give him Dr. Dot. Give him a QU dot for quack.
I usually call him the bogus Doctor.
Nah, they're a quack, but QU. I think that's I don't know.
A QMD.
QUMD.
QMD.
Doctor in Doctor of Quackery.
Quack medical degree. Quack medicine degree.
Oh man. Yeah. With that, I do really gotta get out and mow the lawn.
Yep. It's 8 o'clock. I gotta put kids to bed. So
yeah, it's 7 o'clock here. We got an hour and a half of daylight left. Fortunately, my lawnmower has headlights, so
there you go.
I got 2/3 of it yesterday, so all right, I'm old. See you later. Oh, by the way, real quick, you did see that I pulled the plug on my podcast?
I did not see that.
Okay, yeah, because I just didn't really have the passion for it too much anymore, and quite frankly, I got some personal issues around here that I need to address, but I'm still going with my classic arcade game podcast, mainly because I'm only a co-host. I'm not doing any of the post-production, which really takes up most of the time. So, I pulled the plug. I feel after 5 years, I've pretty much said everything that I need to say. And so.
Yeah, the Bogosity podcast is in its fifth year, and I haven't even started.
Yeah, I just felt like I was repeating myself, kind of like the reason John Cleese left Monty Python.
Yeah. Yeah, well, see, the thing is, I've been deliberately avoiding the kind of stories we repeat ourselves on. Like, I don't really do the cops behaving badly stories.
Yeah, because you can do
that every week.
How many
times
can
you say the same things? Exactly. But, I mean, even after saying, okay, I'm not going to do this anymore, I'm not going to do that anymore, I still have plenty of material.
Right. I'm just glad that I actually had had Trace Beaulieu for Mystery Science Theater on my podcast a while back. So.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, that was episode 150 actually. He was actually on 149, but or 148, but the problem with that was he was in a hotel in Jacksonville, Florida, and his connection kept crapping out. But one of the funniest guys I've ever talked to in my life. So. So anyway,
yeah, but I definitely have to go. I got to get the kids to bed.
So. Like I said, I got to get the mowing done too. All right. So, all right, hey, we'll talk to you later.
All right, thanks to all the co-hosts who showed up. I would thank you by name, but I don't remember who they all were. Thanks to all the viewers. As always, thanks to all the patrons. And we'll see you next time.